Thank you so much, Mr. Rowe. Always good to be back at ABC. As we were singing that song, All I Have Is Christ, I remembered the verse I quoted when I graduated from Appalachian Bible College. When you seniors graduate, you know, you quote what may be a life verse. Mine was Colossians 2:10, "For you are complete in Him who is the head of all principality and power." All I have is Christ, all I need is Christ, we are complete in Him. Students, I want to invite you at 3:30 today to a question and answer. You say, well, we have to be there. Okay, we'll have a good time. You bring your questions, theological questions, practical questions, be thinking about that, and I look forward to that time again with the students. In my first lecture on Christology and the life of Christ, I presented Jesus, the Son of God, especially from Philippians 2, that great kenosis passage about Christ humbling Himself for us, and then from Matthew chapter 1, the historical outworking of the coming of the Son of God to earth. In this lecture, I want to focus on Jesus, the Son of Man, and study the use of that important title in Scripture. The Gospel of John emphasized Christ's deity, and John, whether it's his first epistle or his gospel, states clearly the purpose of the book. Truly, Jesus did many other signs which are in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have eternal life in His name. That's why John was written. And from the first verse on, John makes clear what Son of God means. The Word was God. Now, another feature of John's gospel is that he has numerous life-changing encounters one-on-one. You remember Nicodemus in chapter 3, woman at the well, chapter 4, and so forth through the book, man born blind, chapter 9. And here in the first chapter of John, personal encounters with John the Baptist, Peter, Andrew, Philip, Nathaniel. And in the first chapter alone, 11 titles of Jesus. Just glance in your Bible at John chapter 1, if you would, and I'll point out these 11 titles. Verse 1 and verse 14, the Word. Verse 1, God. Verse 9, the true light. Verse 18, the only begotten Son. 34 and 39, He's called Son of God. In 23, the Lord or Jehovah, quoting from the Old Testament. Of course, John says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He, twice in this chapter, is called Rabbi, teacher. Verse 41, Messiah, which explains means Christ. Verse 49, King of Israel. Verse 51, Son of Man. Now, in his encounter with Nathanael, Jesus Christ uses that term, Son of Man, in an interesting, interesting way. Let me remind you from John's narrative how it unfolded. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, follow me. Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said, we have found him, of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth. Nathanael said to him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Philip gave the right answer. Philip said to him, come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, behold, an Israelite indeed in whom there is no deceit. Nathanael said to him, how do you know me? Jesus said to him, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. Nathanael answered him, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Jesus answered him, because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. Now that Son of Man title is climactic in that encounter with Nathanael and in John chapter 1. And I hope as we survey the uses of Son of Man, especially in the Gospels, that it will become clear why Jesus used that term. First, Son of Man helps us appreciate the humanity of the Son of Man. The Hebrew term, Son of Man, B'nai Adam, can simply mean human, from the category of man. Isaiah 51, 12, who are you that you should be afraid of man who will die? And of the Son of Man who will be made like grass. That parallelism, Son of Man, man. And so it is in Hebrew that sons of Israel or children of Israel means Israelites. Sons of the prophets means from the category of prophet. Even Son of God means God. John 5, 18, for this reason the Jews sought to kill him, not only because he was breaking their Sabbath, but he called himself, excuse me, he called God his very own Father, definition, making himself equal with God. They knew what Son of God meant. But Son of Man, a lowly title, was used in the Old Testament when God addressed different prophets. See, Daniel was called by the Lord, Son of Man. And especially in the book of Ezekiel, 93 times God speaks to Ezekiel and calls him Son of Man. For example, 2:1, Ezekiel writes, he said to me, Son of Man, stand on your feet, and I will speak to you. Now this emphasized to the prophet that he was man, not God, that he was human, not the creator. It also helped the prophet identify with the people to whom they were ministering, as we are fellow humans under the authority of Almighty God. And so Jesus, being Son of Man, emphasizes his humanity. God became a man. He remains a man permanently, as we saw yesterday. He's our sympathetic high priest, went through all kinds of temptations that humans face, yet without sin. And as Mark, in his gospel, the theme verse, combines the idea of humanity and servanthood, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Son of Man, it emphasizes the humanity of Jesus. But it doesn't stop there. Secondly, we need to admire the identity of the Son of Man. It was surprising to me when I learned that Son of Man was Jesus' favorite title for himself. When you read the Gospels, he calls himself Son of Man 80 times. And no one else in the Gospels calls him that. There's once, again, the manuscript's online and you can check out the reference and the documentation, but John 12, 42, how can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? They're using his title for himself, but no one calls him Son of Man, but he calls himself Son of Man 80 times. And only 3 times in the rest of the New Testament is the term used. It's used by Stephen in Acts 7. And it's used twice by John in the revelation of Jesus Christ. Revelation 1:12, Revelation 14:14, John saw a vision of the Son of Man. Other than those three times, Son of Man is Jesus referring to himself. Why did Jesus prefer this title instead of Son of God, King of Israel, Messiah? Probably because it was more humble and less dangerous. To immediately start proclaiming himself as Messiah could have confronted an early challenge from the religious leaders and gotten him put to death before his hour had come. And so he prefers to refer to himself as Son of Man. I'd like us to do a quick survey of Jesus' frequent use of Son of Man and see how he fills it out with more and more meaning as the Gospels move along. Turn in your Bible to Mark chapter 2, and we'll see some examples of Jesus referred to as Son of Man. Mark 2:10. You remember the story? The man's good friends let him down through the flat roof, and Jesus is confronted by the religious leaders about, you know, which is easier to say, take up your bed and walk, or say your sins are forgiven. 2:10, but that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. He said to the paralytic, I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house. The only one who can forgive sins is God, but here Jesus says the Son of Man. Later, Mark 2, verse 27, another time of confrontation with those who did not believe. And he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. So the Son of Man forgives sins. The Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. Mark 8:31, the Son of Man came to suffer and die for sinners. Mark 8:31, and he began to teach that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and 3 days later rise again. Chapter 10, verse 45, I've already referred to the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. You know the theme verse of the Gospel of Luke, perhaps. The Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. And even in John 3, verse 14, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And so the Son of Man forgives sins. The Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. The Son of Man came to suffer and die for sinners. But the Son of Man would rise and rule in his kingdom. Are you in chapter 8 still? Look at verse 38. For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous generation, of him the Son of Man also will be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with his holy angels. And chapter 9, verse 9. Now as he came down from the mountain of transfiguration, he commanded them that they should tell no one the things that they had seen till the Son of Man had risen from the dead. These were not things that a mere man could have done, but God in the flesh, the Son of Man, fulfilled everything that Messiah was here to do, to accomplish the will of God. Jesus used the term Son of Man and filled it with more and more significance. Consider John 5, 27, 28. God the Father, quote, has given him authority to execute judgment also because he is the Son of Man. Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice. What a statement. One day Hitler will hear the voice of Jesus. Abraham Lincoln will hear the voice of Jesus. World leaders that we stand in awe of today, one day will hear the voice of Jesus. You and I, one day, will hear the voice of Jesus when he raises everyone from the dead in his time and in his order, because he is the Son of Man. Now, think of the great white throne judgment, Revelation chapter 20. What an awesome moment. It will be Jesus on that throne. It will be God the Son on that throne. And no one of all the unsaved who will stand before him in that awesome moment will be able to say to him, God, you can't condemn me. You don't know what it's like to live on planet Earth. You don't know what it's like to be tempted. He does. Son of Man, not only who came here and went through all the kinds of temptations we go through, but who also died for our sins so that we wouldn't have to be condemned on that day. The Father has given all judgment to the Son of Man. So, Son of Man showed his humanity, and in a growing way, his identity as Messiah. Third, I'd like us to adore the sovereignty of Son of Man. And for this, to turn to the magisterial Old Testament passage about Son of Man, my favorite book in the Bible, the book of Daniel, and an awesome chapter, Daniel chapter 7. Would you turn there? And we want to read through some of this and look for the Old Testament use of Son of Man. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head while on his bed. Then he wrote down the dream, telling the main facts. Daniel spoke, saying, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea. That's the nations of the world, if you will. And four great beasts came up from the sea, each different from one another. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I watched till the wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the earth to stand on 2 feet. And it was given a man's heart. This, of course, refers to the kingdom of Babylon. Its great king Nebuchadnezzar went through that, losing his mind to show him that God was sovereign. Verse 5, suddenly another great beast, second, like a bear, raised up on one side, had three ribs in its mouth between its teeth, and they said thus to it, Rise, devour much flesh. The kingdom that followed Babylon was Persia, the Medo-Persian Empire. Verse 6. After this I looked, and there was another, like a leopard, which had on its back four wings of a bird. The beast also had four heads, and dominion was given to it. The kingdom that conquered Persia and ruled the known world was Greece. Its great leader, Alexander, died young and was followed by his four generals. All of that is prophesied in that picture. By the way, in Daniel chapter 2, these four kingdoms are pictured as a beautiful, great image. Here in Daniel 7, God is showing that human kingdoms are really beasts. Verse 7, after this I saw in the night vision, and behold, a terrible beast, dreadful and terrible, exceedingly strong. It had huge teeth. It was devouring, breaking in pieces, and trampling the residue with his feet. It was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. The kingdom that defeated Greece and came on the world scene, of course, was the Roman kingdom. And verse 8 talks about its horns, its leaders, and a future form, I believe, of that Roman kingdom. I was considering, and there was another horn, a little one that came up among them, before whom three of the first horns were plucked out. by the roots. And there in this horn were the eyes, like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking pompous words. I think that's the Antichrist, who one day will rule the world. And so there's a gap from the first form of the Roman Empire to the last form of the Roman Empire. That's where we're at in the context, and I don't survey that to get into all the prophetic details. You can study that out. But I want us to see what happens next. I want to read verse 9 to 14. This great vision of God the Father, the Ancient of Days on the throne. And what happens next. In honor of God's Word, let's stand for the reading of this section. Could we do that? Daniel 7, verse 9, you follow along. I watched till thrones were put in place, and the Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was white as snow. The hair of his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, and its wheels burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. In other words, you can't get close to God. 1,000 thousands ministered to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was opened, and the court was seated, and the books were opened. This is God eternal on the throne of the universe. And what happens next would have jarred Jewish readers to their core. Verse 11. I watched because of the sound of the pompous words which the horn was speaking. I watched till the beast was slain, its body was destroyed, given to the burning fire. As for the rest of the beasts, they had dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. And as I was watching in the night vision, behold, one like the Son of Man, a human being, came to the Ancient of Days, comes right up to the throne of God. And they brought him near before him. Then to him, the Son of Man, was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed. Brothers and sisters, this is King Jesus. Entering his Father's throne room for the pronouncement of judgment on all earthly evil kingdoms, and to receive the kingdom, to rule for 1,000 years, and then to give that kingdom to his Father and rule forever and ever, according to 1 Corinthians 15. It's an awesome scene. Jesus knew it. Thank you. You may be seated. We need to adore the sovereignty of the Son of Man, the glorious vision of who he really is. Jewish readers of the Old Testament must have scratched their heads over this, that one like the Son of Man, a human being, would approach the throne of God. It reminds me of Revelation chapter 5. Do you remember that great vision? Revelation 4, the setting, God on the throne, worshipped by the angels, worshipped by the elders, and then that search in chapter 5, who is worthy to take the scroll, and who comes to open the scroll, which is the title deed of the earth and the universe? The Lamb. He's the lion, but he's the Lamb. He takes the scroll from his Father and begins to unfold all God's purposes for planet Earth in the rest of the book of Revelation. It's Jesus' identity as the Son of Man that ultimately got him killed. I don't know if you've noticed that before, but turn to Matthew 26. One of the Jewish trials of Jesus in that horrible night when the Jewish religious leaders were determined to find grounds to put him to death because of their unwillingness to repent and acknowledge who he really was. Matthew 26:63. But Jesus kept silent. And the high priest answered and said to him, I put you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. What would Jesus say? Jesus says to him, it is as you say. Nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven. That's the Shekinah glory of God. That's Daniel chapter 7. Then the high priest tore his clothes, saying, he has spoken blasphemy. What further need do we have of witnesses? Look now, you have heard this blasphemy. What do you think? They answered, he is deserving of death. This was the climactic moment in the Jewish trial before they hauled him off to Pilate. Sitting at the right hand of power, it's from Psalm 110. The Lord said to my Lord, Yahweh said to Adonai, sit on my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. It's messianic. And the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven is straight from Daniel chapter 7. And the high priest Caiaphas knew it. He accused him of blasphemy, and he condemned Jesus to death. I'd like to show a short video clip taken from The Passion of the Christ. And if you've seen that movie, you know that it was filmed in the original languages. The Jews were speaking Aramaic. The Romans were speaking Greek, and we have to look at the subtitles. But we're going to pick up this scene just for about 2.5 minutes.
Eshalak Yeshuansaret Amar lana en ant Meshiacha bar Elachachai. Echo Eana Taxon Barnash, if they by me, Khail, take on a nation. Shila. Good God, Shabila. Hakashki Alachna, Al Shahadu, Shamin, Mila. Seraph, come!
Jesus gave a good confession. He did that for you and me. And about 2 years later, one of his followers by the name of Stephen was on trial before this very group. Probably many of the same Sanhedrin members were there. And we see the identity of the Son of Man confirmed, vindicated. Turn your Bible to Acts chapter 7 as we get ready in a few moments to land this plane. You remember that Stephen was dragged in Jerusalem before the Sanhedrin for preaching Jesus, the Messiah, the Savior, the Lord of all. And he accused them, after surveying the history of Israel, of rejecting their promised Messiah, Jesus. You follow along as I read, beginning verse 51. "You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit, as your fathers did. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who foretold the coming of the Just One, of whom you have now become the betrayers and the murderers, who have received the law by the direction of angels and have not kept it." You killed your Messiah. What boldness of Stephen before this very same group. What happened next? Verse 54 was that when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart and they gnashed at him with their teeth. Not they repented, but they became filled with rage. And then what happens must have sent cold chills down their backs. Notice what Stephen says, verse 55. "He, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, 'Look, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God.'" He is the Son of Man. He is risen, he's ascended, and he is at the Father's right hand even now, this Son of Man, as he pleads with them to repent and to turn to Christ. Hearing of the vision of the Son of Man on the heavenly throne, the members of the Sanhedrin ignored all legal protocol, rushed at Stephen, stoned him to death. And they laid their coats at the feet of a young man. What was that young man's name? Saul. That's right. Saul heard Stephen call on God, heard Stephen ask Jesus to receive his spirit as the Savior seated at his Father's right hand stands to welcome home the first martyr. And he loudly prayed like Jesus had, "Lord, do not charge them with this sin." And Peter died and went to heaven as the first martyr, martyros, Greek, witness, gave his life for the Son of Man, for the living Christ. Now you know, as the book of Acts progresses, that this Saul takes the persecution outside Jerusalem, begins to chase down Christians because he believed that they were preaching a false Messiah. You know that it was this Saul who had the authority of the high priest, perhaps of the very Sanhedrin, to chase down Christians and decided to go to Syria and to its capital, Damascus. And as he's on that road, a light from heaven, Acts chapter 9, blinds him and strikes him and his traveling party to the ground. And a voice from heaven, "Saul, Saul." And he, as a Jew, the Shekinah glory of God from heaven, he knew who that was. And what does Saul say? "Who are you, Lord?" And the voice from heaven, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." He was jarred to his soul and was never the same again. And you know that he was converted to faith in Jesus as his Lord, his Savior, and became perhaps the greatest missionary of all time, author of 13 books in our New Testament. Stephen's witness to the Son of Man in heaven impacted Saul greatly and prepared the way for Jesus arresting Saul on the road to Damascus. I am Jesus. And when you're persecuting my church, you're persecuting me. Well, it's my prayer that this study of the Son of Man will move us from appreciating his humanity, he really was a man, to admiring his identity, he fulfilled all that the Messiah was to do, and adoring his sovereignty on heaven's throne. You know Romans 10:9, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is the Lord, you will be what? Saved. We invite you to him in this age of grace. We will all stand before the Son of Man one day. Every knee will bow to him and every tongue will confess to God, Romans 14. Will you stand before him at that great white throne to hear him say, "Depart from me into everlasting fire"? See, that's what we deserve. We've sinned against an infinite holy God. But he's also a God of grace, whose Son came to give his life for us. And he's borne the wrath of God. He's borne our hell. And that's why if you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. For whoever will call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. That's the good news we have to proclaim. And if there's even one here that you're not certain things are right between you and God forever, come to Jesus. He's that ladder to heaven. He is the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. But when you come to Jesus, he doesn't just show you the way. He is the way. He's not a stairway that we climb to reach God. He is, if you will, an escalator. When you get on, he takes you there to his Father's house that we can enjoy forever. And if you know that you've received him, my question for you is this. How will you fare when we stand before Jesus, you and me, as believers at the Bema, the judgment seat of Christ? We want to hear him say, what? Well done, good and faithful servant. It doesn't say good and fancy servant, good and successful servant. It says what? Good and faithful servant. That's what we're living for, isn't it? Not for ourselves, but for him who loved us, gave himself for us. The Son of Man, the Son of God, the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords. What a privilege to serve him. Let's pray. Father, I confess that my greatest problem in ministry is when I get my eyes off of Jesus, onto circumstances, onto people, onto things of this world. Lord, forgive me for every time. And I pray for my brothers and sisters here today that you will help them to put their eyes firmly on Christ, on our loving Lord Jesus. Lord, sometimes we get so busy in ministry we neglect the Master. Forgive us. I pray that we would keep our eyes on you. Thank you for the great privilege we have to take this good news to a lost and needy world. And Lord, I pray for these students that they would feel your call to go and represent Jesus, to go and teach and preach his word, to give this good news to the ends of the earth. That we might hear your well done one day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.